all the type rating have their own value. So you think carefully and then you decide.
As you are working in a different airline, in a different country.
And to the viewers, make sure you like, comment, share, and subscribe to his channel for more. Peace.
Hey guys, what's up? I am Arpit Mahajan, and welcome back to the channel Flying Wing. Keep watching. So guys, as I got some questions related to aviation and related to pilot career. So guys, for clearing that, we are having one pilot with us who will be clearing your doubts, and I hope your doubts will be getting clear related to CPL, related to type rating and all of that. So guys, do watch this vlog fully and don't forget to click on the subscribe button. So guys, let's welcome sir. Hello sir, how are you?
Hello Arpit, good morning. I'm fine, thank you. I hope you're good too. First of all, I would like to apologize for not having this conversation before. Because of my busy schedule, I was unable to find any time to give you a call. However, today I'm free, so let's do this. And for the people who are watching, my name is Vignesh, and I'm a senior first officer here in an international airlines in Vietnam.
So, sir, can you tell us something about your journey, like how you start and achieve a seat in a cockpit?
Okay, so my dream to become an airline pilot started at a very young age, actually. And the first problem I faced was after I finished my year 12, when I actually started researching about how to become an airline pilot. I saw that in India, everyone they ask for maths and physics in year 12, which I did not have because I am a commerce student. So I applied for a flying school in Melbourne, Australia, and surprisingly, they did not require maths and physics. All they required was IELTS English, which they needed more than 6 bands, and they need class 1 and class 2 medical, and that's pretty much all they require. However, I realized after getting to Australia and I started my training and my theory and everything, I realized why they need maths and physics in India, because it, of course, it makes things easier for you to understand. Your theory and everything becomes easier. So for me, I had to work twice as much. I did all my hard work and I cleared all my theory exams, and I obtained my license.
So, sir, as you are working in a different country, in a different airline, like an international airline, so what type of difference you've seen here and there?
Well, the obvious difference that I notice working as a pilot in an Indian carrier and working here in a different country is the first, the salary that you get, maybe double or triple of what an Indian first officer will make. The second obvious difference is the language, I would say. Actually, well, everybody speaks English, so in an aviation industry, so it's not a big deal. However, there are certain people who cannot understand English fluently, and they only speak in Vietnamese in my case. So it's always a good idea to learn the local language. It'll benefit a lot.
Sir, it's a funny question you can say, or interesting question you can say. Some students have a class 1 phobia. So, some words from you for that.
Class 1 medical phobia, yes. It's fairly common, I think. I'm pretty sure everyone goes through this and gets it done. Before getting into that, I would like to say that aviation is actually a very expensive industry. Starting from the school fees to your flight training and even the type rating, everything is very expensive. So, the first step into aviation is doing the class 1 medical, because it's very important. I know many people, they have this phobia and they end up ignoring it, avoiding it in the beginning, and they you know, go through the process of, you know, their theory and pay the school fees and everything. And once they finally do the class one, and if it's a bad news for them, it's a very, very, very expensive loss. So it's okay. The medical is not actually too complicated. It's very easy. You don't have to worry about anything. The medical is good for you only. They make sure that you are safe and the passengers that you will be carrying in future are safe. So the first step into the aviation is the class one medical. Just get that done first, and then you can focus on the other thing.
So sir, one more question. It's an amazing question, you can say, and I have also in touch for that question, that which is the best option, like a cadet program or a conventional program, as many students have a doubt for that. Sir, can you tell me something about that?
Well, Arpit, this is actually a debatable topic. There is no right or wrong answer to it. So I can only give you my personal opinion, because I came through a cadet program. I joined this airline as a cadet pilot. I got my hours, or they trained me on the Airbus A320. And after I finished my training successfully, I got the contract by the airlines. So it depends. There is no right or wrong answer. Some people get successful with the other one, and some people get success with the cadet program. So it's debatable. So personally, in my opinion, I would suggest cadet program, because while you are a cadet, you will have everything current, your medical, your license, your flying hours, and it will be recent. So even though the airline that you're flying as a cadet for does not hire you, you have a very good chance of getting hired in another airline, because all your hours are in the type, and all your takeoffs and landings and your medical and everything is current, so you don't have to worry about it. So yeah.
So sir, as you're working in a different airline, in a different country, so what type of a recruitment process is there, like rounds of an interview? Can you tell me something about that?
Yep, this is actually a very important question as well, and a very good question. Thank you for that. As you know, I'm working in Vietnam. So in my case, even before the recruitment process, I had to convert my license to Vietnamese license, and I had to do my medical here in Vietnam and get the Vietnamese class 1 and class 2 medical. Then after that, during the recruitment, before the panel interview, you have to do a psychometric test and ICAO English test. And after that, you will be sitting in front of the firing squad, which is there was a panel of four people. They will be interviewing you. They will be asking you questions, basic aeronautical questions, and probably they will give you scenarios and everything. And according to your answers, they will decide whether you are good for the company or not. That's all.
So it's one of the questions from my side. Can a person doing a job, like in any airline or some other job, can he do CPL side by side?
Yeah, you can do job and do CPL side by side. In my case, that's what I did. I was working part time in Australia while I was doing my CPL, so it's not a big deal. But if you're doing full time job, it could be a little difficult, because as I said, CPL is an expensive investment. And I would say you take your investment seriously, but if you can handle both of them, go for it, man. It's not a big deal.
So as I heard that it takes patience to get the job in an aviation, sir, some words from you and your views for this question.
Well, you're right. You need to have a lot of patience to get a job in aviation. For those people who still cannot find a job, I do have a suggestion and a tip. That instead of emailing your resumes to the company, I would say you print out your resumes and personally hand out your resumes to the company head office. In my case, that's what I did. I traveled to Indonesia, I traveled to Papua New Guinea, I traveled to Vietnam, I traveled to Philippines, and I was personally handing out my resumes to them. This shows your motivation, it shows your passion towards aviation, and it shows your confidence as well. So that could work out on your favor, instead of just sitting at home and just emailing your resumes to the company.
So sir, if a student want to do a typewriting before a job, so can he do I know he can do, but is it a good option, or you can say a good decision? So from your views, on which aircraft he or she should do a type rating?
Well, type rating is serious. First of all, type rating is commitment, and it is expensive. So you have to be very careful in choosing which aircraft you want to be type rated in. I would suggest you get type rating according to the airline's requirement. If you are sure that you will get a job in that airline and they require you to have, I don't know, Boeing type rating, only then you do the type rating, because it's commitment, man. And once you have a Boeing type rating, you can only apply for airlines which have Boeing aircrafts. So of course that limits your job search. You want to have an Airbus A320 type rating, you can only apply for airlines which have Airbus A320 or A321. In my case, I did the A320 type rating, and I can only apply for, you know, airlines which have Airbus A320, which is probably the most common aircraft in the world right now. So that's what I did. I'm not suggesting you do the same. You make your own decision, you think, because all the type rating have their own value. So you think carefully and then you decide.
Sir, some motivation words from you for the upcoming youth?
For young pilots and for the youth, all I can say is when everything seems to be going against you, always remember that the aircraft takes off against the wind, not with it. And believe that you can, and you're already halfway there.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for coming on our channel and giving us your precious time. Thank you so much, sir.
Thanks, Arpit, man, for doing this. I had a great time. I hope I shared something of value from my experience. And if your viewers have any questions or doubts, they can use the comment section down below. And to the viewers, make sure you like, comment, share, and subscribe to his channel for more. Peace.